For some, balancing on one leg is easy. However, take away that person's sight and this task becomes more challenging. Now, strip away a person's sense of hearing and the task that used to be easy is now quite difficult. In order to keep the body upright and grounded while balancing, the brain uses three sources of information: eyes, ears, and proprioception. The eyes provide the brain a sense of where the head and body are in space with respect to the surrounding environment. The ears house fluid-filled semicircular canals that tell the brain whether the head is level to the ground. And proprioception, it helps the body stay aware of where the joints are in space, providing feedback to the brain when joints and muscles have to move to compensate for trying to stay balanced. Specifically addressing proprioception's relationship to balance control, recent studies have noted how ankle proprioception may be one of the most important components to balance control because of its direct contact relationship with the ground. Dance training has been shown to improve a dancer's proprioceptive abilities and is one of the fundamental reasons why dancers are able to flawlessly execute complex balance movements on a very small base of support, with light shining in their eyes and while under constant pressure from a judgmental audience. Hi, my name is Anna, a current senior studying neuroscience and dance, and my presentation will take you on my research journey that explored how proprioception may be improved through dance technique. My initial research on the relationship between proprioception and balance through a dance lens naturally led me to an earlier study done by Dr. Lee in 2009. Identifying three professional sports that must passively train their ankle joints, him and his colleagues examined the ankle proprioception in young regular practitioners of ice hockey, running, and ballet dancing. Importantly, results showed that ballet dancers and hockey players had a statistically significant increase in proprioception of the ankle when compared to the sedentary group. This suggests that dancing could have a greater impact on ankle proprioception and could be used as a form of therapy to increase an individual's proprioceptive abilities. If proprioception is able to be improved through dance intervention, then there may be a possibility to take advantage of that relationship to aid healing for individuals with chronic diseases, or even act as a preventative therapy to prevent the elderly from self-injury. That's exactly what Dr. Jung and her colleagues researched in 2019. 82 older adults were split into two groups, an experimental group participating in creative dance and a control group participating in stretch training. For 8 weeks, each participated in two 90-minute sessions of their respective assigned group. 8 weeks later, the results showed a significant increase in gait speed during the 10-meter walking test for individuals in the CD group, suggesting that creative dance could improve dynamic balance and mobility more than stretching for elderly individuals. If the elderly individuals are able to walk at a quicker pace with more confidence through their increase in proprioception, then they may also have more control of their body. And greater control of their body leads to a healthier and safer aging process. Thus, having dance used as an alternative therapy in medicine to increase an individual's proprioception and balance could be a large milestone for the elderly population, because they could participate in a social dance style that also reaps positive health benefits. Taking research into my own hands, I conducted two case studies with two college-age males, one mover who exercises 6 to 7 hours a week, called MV, and a non-mover who does not exercise throughout the week, called NM. I wanted to see if there would be improvement in their static balance after training. My hypothesis for these experiments were that regardless of previous exercising capabilities and experience, both would be able to improve the average amount of time that they can balance on the trained foot when compared to their control foot. Gaining inspiration from the other scholarly work that I have read, my protocol was to balance every day for 10 minutes on their right leg with their eyes closed. On day 0, 15, and 30, both would record themselves balancing on each leg 3 times, amounting to a total of 18 trials per individual and 2 short interviews pre and post experiment. First, focusing on the non-mover's anecdotal evidence collected, it was expected to see him quite off balance. And when he does lose his balance, whether that be on his control foot or his trained foot, he seems to rely more on his upper body than his ankle for balance support. Now, comparing day 0 and day 30, even though the average amount of time that the non-mover balances on either foot did not increase, it does seem like he's more aware of the relationship his foot has with the ground by day 30. In videos, you can notice that there's some subtle foot adjustments made to maintain stability. What stood out to me when interviewing him was how he mentioned how he could have gone longer. It was just that his foot got tired, specifically the ankle and the calf region. Analyzing the mover's videos, it seemed his initial videos are similar to the non-mover's in that the mover also varies arm positions to find the best way to balance at that moment in time. Although average balance times did not increase for either leg after 30 days, You do see our mover subject a little more straight up, which again could be attributed to him using his core and in turn is able to balance without the use of his arms as a counterweight. Interviewing our mover, he didn't really think he improved. He thought he was pretty good at balancing in the first place and mentioned that his foot did not get tired unless it was already tired from daily workouts. That was a cool difference I found between the two, their level of tiredness after balancing. I think it could be attributed to the fact that the mover probably knows his body better. The mover is probably activating the least amount of muscles to balance, whereas our non-mover individual probably does not know what muscles to use while balancing. Although my results not initially support my hypothesis that they would both have an increase in balance times, I think the results of my two case study reports partially support the literature review. Yes, the males did not necessarily balance on one leg for longer, but they did seem to have a better sense of their ankle joint positioning, which has been associated with an increase in proprioceptive abilities. Looking at future implications, as the research for new therapeutics develop, proprioception research has the capabilities to slowly expand and become a more interdisciplinary work, specifically with dance through dance movement therapy, which is an alternative treatment that uses dance movements to alleviate symptoms of an illness. And to highlight, a recent study in 2015 suggested that elderly use proprioception rather than their visual and vestibular cues to control postural movements and balance. Parkinson's disease, one of many neurological disorders, causes the individual to lose their balance and have a hard time walking. Now, with the average age of Parkinson's disease being around 60 and the ankle proprioception being one of the main contributors to balance, future therapists could tailor regimen movements to what the patients specifically need, such as ankle-specific stability movement sequences for Parkinson's disease patients. Not only could targeted regimen increase effectiveness of treatment, but it could also result in a longer-lasting effect on proprioception when compared to non-targeted dance movement therapy. Preliminary data in recent years has also shown a relationship between cervical neck proprioception and individuals with chronic neck pain. A potential therapy to look into for these people could be neck-specific dance movement therapy regimens, providing a novel alternative approach for a condition where current standard treatment typically consists of solely pharmaceutical approaches. Although some may believe that proprioception is not that vital to our daily lives, this sixth sense has actually proved to be an essential mechanism of the body in order to complete daily tasks, such as walking the dog, grabbing groceries, or even maintaining balance. As mentioned, earlier studies have shown that dance is one effective way to improve proprioception and could be used as a creative, preventative, targeted therapy for elderly or persons with Parkinson's disease. As cohesive as a story seems, further research regarding proprioception's relationship to dance movement therapy, ankle taping, and even fascia could be conducted in order to better understand how proprioception works and how future therapeutics can capitalize on this knowledge to create disease-tailored regimens. By honing in on the best dance therapeutic practices built upon proprioception knowledge and understanding, healthcare providers in the future will have a more effective alternative treatment option for chronic neurological illnesses with physical impairments.